For the session methodology, Mary has some of those too. If you if you're like me, I leave things on my desk before I leave in the morning. So go ahead and just raise your hand and she can get those to you. So this is the compilation of all the comments that we received. They're not in full, but they are in part. It looks like we have a full crowd. That's a fairly full crowd. A few seats empty, but can everybody hear me okay? I got a thumbs up. I got another thumbs up. Got another thumbs up. Okay. All right. Good. Just to go over a few housekeeping things, which excuse me. Okay. Good. And that's going to be the. I apologize for. Let me wait a minute. My name is Sarah Clem. I'm the branch manager of the Water Quality Planning Branch in the Office of Water Quality, and our group in the Planning Branch is responsible for developing the assessment methodology and assessing the waters of the state, and then getting that to EPA Region 6. So, and that's why we're all here. But we'll go over a bit of that. But what was I going to say? I think I'll wait until we get to the slide that discusses housekeeping. This is just what I wanted to do is first welcome you. Thank you very much for taking the time. This is 3 hours out of your day. And this is not the only session that we've planned. And so thank you very much. I know that it's a lot of time, but we feel it's important to get everyone's input of all the groups that are represented here. So thank you very much. And I want to say thank you to all the Planning Branch staff that has helped put this together. I have done about 0.1% of everything that is happening. So Mary Barnett here, Christy Williams back here, and Jim Wise, who's over here, and others have spent a lot of time to get this together. The compilation of comments that you have and so on is all they're doing and not mine. And then last but not least is Caleb Osborne. I want to introduce our Associate Director of Office of Water Quality, Caleb Osborne, over here. And you guys can see that because of these handy-dandy name tents that we have. So I think that covers that. Let me get my coffee, so if my throat gets parched, then I'll have something to drink. So hang on just a second. Oh, just a quick thing. If you wouldn't mind, I'm sure everybody has a cell phone for today. If you wouldn't mind muting that, if you haven't already, we would really appreciate that. So this is the very first stakeholder work group meeting that we have had related to the assessment methodology. We have received comments about this and having this type of meeting and input for some time, at least two cycles I can recall where this input was given to us. And so we now are beginning the stakeholder work group for the assessment methodology. We've done this we've done this with regulation number 2. Some of you may have participated in that, but this is the first time we're doing it for the assessment methodology. So again, we're very happy to have you. And so we are reviewing the 2016 assessment methodology in preparation for developing the 2018 assessment methodology. So let me finish this. Christy, are you? You're not running that. Okay, good. All of a sudden it moved and I didn't do it. I thought somebody else was doing it. Some housekeeping. Some of you have come here before, maybe not, but the restrooms are right down the way, and the women's you'll get to first. You see the exit sign, you take the first right, and then the essentially it's the elevator column that goes up and down. That's where the restrooms are for men and women. In case of a fire, use that side door just right there. We're super safe here. We have coffee, and today we have some donuts and some cute little smiley face cookies. Some iced smiley face cookies, which I love. We may not have enough for everybody, but get them while you can. So today we're going to run from 9 to 12, and we'll conclude on time. We will not be able to get through all of, I can't imagine us getting through everything that we need to get through in this one session. We anticipate having at least one more session, and we have two as well in January. I think everyone signed in, I hope. If you haven't, please do. And those who are participants, direct stakeholders at the table, there's a special sheet for you. If you can make sure you initial that every time that we have a session, that way we can keep up with attendance. So this is, everyone knows this. I feel like your mom, but we want to make sure we're on time. We're a little late today. We're just getting started. But for start time and breaks, we have two set aside. So please be prompt in getting back. We want to keep the discussions relevant to the topic at hand. We're going to go through the assessment methodology section by section. And it will, I can see how it will bleed over into other sections, but we want to try to stay on topic. And so I will try to manage that, as well as I think Mary has taken on the responsibility of helping that as well. And also, as always, please remain respectful of all of others' opinions. And we want to make sure that you use the microphones, which I don't think we have handed out yet. No. We'll be going to do that here in a minute. So each side is going to have a microphone. I do recall in our Regulation 2 Triennial Review Stakeholder Work Group meeting, it was difficult to hear folks at times. We have a much larger group than we did then, and so we are going to have microphones. And so as much as we're able to, please use the microphones. Even though maybe people have always told you that you project really well, just go ahead and try to use microphones if we can. Always speak one at a time. It's going to be very easy to have side conversations. But please try to minimize those. We've established breaks for that purpose. So if you have folks who would want to talk with you about a particular section that maybe has been discussed, that's why we've established the breaks. And if you could announce your name before you speak, for folks calling in, and that's Selena. Selena, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Wow. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, good. Thank you, Terry. Okay. I didn't get that. Who was that? Oh, Tim Snell. Great, great. We have your name tents, everybody. They're waiting for you. The revision, timeline for revision. We've had the public listening session. Some of you came to that or submitted comments. That time has passed, and those comments. Okay, thank you.
Debbie Moore, AHD.
Oh. Anyone else?
I'll be here.
Thank you. So the public listening session has occurred, and those comments that were received during the public listening session are in the compilation of comments that you have before you. So we'll be reviewing those and going over those. We're now in the stakeholder work group session phase two of this review of the assessment methodology. We anticipate two sessions in December and two sessions in January. A summary of input will be in February, and then we're going to have a public notice time period to respond to those comments, and we'll have a finalized methodology that can be utilized for the 303D list. So let's talk about the assessment methodology. Why are you here? What does the assessment methodology mean? Some of you know or are intimately familiar with the assessment methodology. Maybe others are not. So we wanted to set aside just a few moments to go through what the assessment methodology really is. And this is not digging into the meat of it or the weeds, but we'll get there. So every 2 years, ADEQ must assess the waters of the state to determine if they are supporting the designated uses and attaining water quality criteria. Those water quality criteria are in regulation number 2. So this is required by the Clean Water Act that we do this. The assessment methodology contains procedures for this assessment that we have to do every 2 years. It's prepared by ADEQ staff, primarily the primarily the bulk of the yeoman's work is with the planning branch. It has to be consistent with Reg 2. That's another thing that's going to, I think, be a point to remember throughout these discussions, is it has to be consistent with Reg 2, and it must be scientifically based, the assessment methodology. It determines attainment and non-attainment of uses and criteria. So what we wanted to do in this, can everybody see that okay? Do we need to dim the lights? Some folks are squinting their eyes. We're good? Okay. So the Clean Water Act requirements, and so if you look the first from top to bottom, the first five are primarily, those responsibilities are with the planning branch, and then we move to the permit limits. But at first, you have to adopt the water quality standards. That is an ongoing process. It's done every 2 years, according to the Clean Water Act. We have to do that. I'm sorry, every 3 years, triennial review. So with that, we're required to monitor the waters of the state, which we do. We have around 150 or more water quality monitoring stations throughout the state. The data that comes from those, we utilize and assess that data, essentially filter it through, compare it to the assessment methodology in Reg 2. We get that, and we come up with our assessments, whether it is attaining its uses and criteria or not. And from that, that's where we get the impaired water bodies list, the 303D list. That's Section 303D of the Clean Water Act. And from there, this is what we're focusing on very specifically. What we will do, the assessment methodology and the assessment process, what comes from that and the impaired water bodies list is part of the integrated report, or the 305B report, and that is developed every 2 years. We're required to develop that every 2 years using a 5-year period of record. We'll get to that. And then ultimately, we will develop the TMDLs, total maximum daily loads, will be developed for those impaired water bodies, and then we will develop, and then permit limits are developed from, well, the TMDL on the load allocation is given in the permit limitations. So the assessment process, we have our water quality data, all those stations that I mentioned across the state, we gather all that data. We use the assessment methodology along with Reg 2, and we determine whether a stream segment is impaired or not impaired. So for example, let's look at pH. So the criteria in Reg 2 say that pH must be between 6 and 9 standard units and are the applicable standards for streams. It's also the applicable standards for lakes as well. But the assessment methodology says stream segments will be listed as non-support when a variance from the pH standard occurs in more than 10% of the total samples within the period of record. So let's break that down. Here's an example data set. The pH water quality criterion is 6 to 9. Three of the 10 samples are outside the criterion. They're greater than 10%. If these were the only qualifying data available for this water body, it would be listed on the 303D list of impaired water bodies. So that's just a brief glimpse into a very straightforward assessment. Now, there are other criteria where the assessment is more complicated than that, but this is the basic process that we would go through. So you're in this stakeholder process that we've initiated. So we've identified our stakeholders. We're now, we've gathered input. We'll gather more input, but we're going to discuss all that input. And then from that, the objective of this group is to make recommendations on the revision of the assessment methodology. And so this is broken down for us. Identify the stakeholders. We've done that. There are representatives here from local, state, and federal government entities, industrial, municipal, utility entities, conservation and environmental entities are represented here. We gather that input during the listening session, and we've compiled those relevant comments. Discussions will follow. the current layout of the assessment methodology. It's just start to finish. We need to remain on topic. Stakeholder input is critical to achieving the process goals. The work group should provide ADQ with recommendations for revising the 2018 assessment methodology for the next listing cycle. That's why we're here. Recommendations can be changes, clarifications, additions, deletions to the current methodology. All, but keep in mind, it all must be scientifically based, what's in the assessment methodology. So you can keep up to date on the website. Please do that. Sign up for the listserv if you are not already. The stakeholders here that are at the table are you're in your own batch of list. You're on your own specific list. So we will, if anything changes or any documentation needs to come out, you guys will get it directly. But we will ensure that it's also on the website for all the other folks that are interested in the process. So we expect everyone to have reviewed the assessment methodology. It's not something you want to like stay up and read the last thing, you know, before you go to bed, because you'll fall asleep pretty quick. But we definitely want your critical input for throughout this process. This lets you know where everything is on our website. That it looks fairly bare when you first get on there. It just says related documents, but if you click on that, you get a big drop-down menu. So keep that in mind. And then, anything you may have any questions about today before we get started? We're just going to dig in from the top to bottom. Yes, Ryan. It's what we use for the two.
It's not changed from that. And then was it mutually agreed upon?
That's a good question. He's asking if it's mutually agreed upon with EPA. What I can say is that just with discussions with EPA, there has the use of that particular language was not used. I think we're to a point. I don't know whether they would agree to mutually agreed upon. They have not utilized that language. It is that particular language is used in the guidance document for the integrated report that Ryan's talking about, but I do not recall them using that specifically. I mean, we've made a lot of progress, but. Yeah.
I didn't see where they provided comments in this process so far. Do you have unresolved comments from the last one?
Oh, right. Sorry. Do we have unresolved comments from EPA from the last one is what I'm trying to figure out.
It should be, my recollection is what we tried to include was the comments submitted for the 2016 list by Stacy Dwyer.
Okay.
Who's the head of permits. Are they not in there? They're not in
there. No, I didn't see anything from EPA. That's why
good.
I was wondering.
Okay. 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 But so that's a good point. That's a good point. Yes, Colleen.
Mary, you sent out yesterday an email with attachments that said revised or something compilation. So I take it I didn't have time to look at what you attached yesterday. I had previously looked at the compilation that was sent out last week. Is there a difference in the two?
The main difference is that ADEQ's comments were not included in the main compilation, the first one, and we thought it would help with the flow of review for those to be included. Also, we took a harder look. There were some comments that were included under general comments. We took a harder look at how those might have actually fit in the methodology, and so we moved some of those comments up.
So we should make sure we use the one you sent out yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As we're going through this. And then has it been substituted on the website?
I did submit the request for that to happen, but I haven't received verification yet.
Okay. Thank you.
You can just keep it right there and hand it to the next person. Are there any other? So thanks very much, and we can we'll look into the EPA's comments.
Sarah?
Sorry.
It came from behind me. I'm sorry.
I had a question going back on expectations from
yes.
this group. What
do we want
ADEQ
to go back?
Expects this group to do?
Yes.
And you said make recommendations.
That's correct.
So I'm curious as when we what context of the recommendations are you looking for? Are you looking for a consensus from the group, or are you just looking for issues that
mm-hmm.
the group cannot resolve between itself that ADEQ needs to address, or what are the expectations of ADEQ when you say a recommendation?
Right. Okay. So let's take into consideration. Let's use that scenario. Say we get to a point on a particular section or issue where the group is not in consensus, or the group is not in agreement. What we're going to do? Let's just say. This side does not agree with this side. What we're going to do is capture that difference. We're going to capture whatever the recommendation may be from this side versus this side. We're going to capture that, and that will our intent is to take all these recommendations and give them and compile them and review that internally and submit them and talk with the director about them. Because we see her as having the decision rest with her on this, really, because it comes from the department. And so what we're going to do is ensure that both sides of the issue are heard. That's our intent, is to capture the lack of consensus, or essentially, what each group sees and wants to recommend. That's what we're going to do. Does that make sense? But I didn't answer it all. So,
well,
go ahead.
You did, in
I didn't. So,
in a sense,
what?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So, because obviously, I can predict that there's going to be unresolved issues between
yes.
members of the group. So, I was just wondering
mm-hmm.
how ADEQ plans to handle that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, y'all are the final decision maker on it by when. Mm-hmm. You published the final document. The other one was a question has to do with the depth of the discussion, because it seems
mm-hmm.
reading the comments, there are a lot of comments, and some of them are very technical in nature, and then
mm-hmm.
some of them are kind of much more a higher level.
Yes.
And on the website where it talks about this process, you have four meetings, and I noticed that two of them in January were parenthetically noted if needed.
Yes.
So my sense was that y'all don't expect a great deal of depth of technical discussions in this group?
No, not at all. We it's based on our experience from the training review. We were able to go through the reg fairly quickly. We just built in extra dates. So say we do get through them. I don't know. Say everybody agrees with we have consensus, or there's no split in recommendation or anything like that. We could get through it fairly quickly. It's just a plan B if we needed more time. But as far as the depth of discussion, we expect to have to dig in. That's why we're here. I can see how some members of the stakeholder work group may not be as intimately familiar with the assessment methodology, but we're hoping that everyone digs in and is able to give good recommendations and comments. Yeah, we don't want to limit the depth of it. Yes, Colleen.
And just as a follow-up to Mike's comment,
mm-hmm.
I'm a little concerned about the timeline, because it does seem to me pretty ambitious, but maybe your experience on Reg 2 is, you'll be right, that this will just go very quickly.
It may not.
But I'm wondering if we can have some process to either give you some written input after the first, after this meeting, because I think there are going to be some issues that, we talk about, we need to think about, we need to
Absolutely.
Talk to other people, we
Yep.
need to research.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be possible for us to you know, email in some additional thoughts or something, so that, in other words, I'm a little bit concerned that we'll cover pH, just because you showed that.
Right.
And, you know, we'll talk about it, but I don't want that to be the, you know, if we talk about it today, that it's done. We've talked about pH, so we're not going to come back and address anything else on that.
So if you look, I believe it's in our, I believe it's in the agenda. If not, we, can I borrow that, sir? It's in the, let me check. Outstanding topics of future discussions. So what we wanted to do is actually have time for that, that type of, so say we're in the second session, where it's a next, it's a 15th or whenever the next one is, 14th, 15th. And so we totally expect, because to have to revisit some of these. So say we end up on an issue and, you know, you dig in, everyone digs into it a little deeper. It's like, we really need to revisit that. There's a time allocated to revisit those. It's like outstanding topics and future discussion. That's the kind of the place where toward the end we expect to revisit, just for everybody, we intend to revisit some of these issues maybe that people have ruminated on, you researched on, maybe you've looked at other states. It's like, you know, this might be a good idea for us. So we totally expect that. We, and as it relates to the stakeholder work group and getting input from you guys during in the interim between these sessions, our intent is just to cover that. If you can either send that in to us, we're going to make sure that all the stakeholder work group gets the input so everyone can see what everyone's saying. Absolutely. Does that make sense? Okay. Good questions. Yes. Can you talk in that little microphone? Yeah, that's okay. You might need to put. Yeah, it works. Good.
Is it live?
You're live.
Okay. So that you don't get inundated, is email the way you prefer to hear from us?
Yes, please. That would be the best way to ensure that we're capturing everyone's input. Because I don't know if we try to translate it. You know, we may miss something, or so if we could write it out, that would be best, and so everybody can see it, because we want everyone's input. Does anybody have anything else? We've got a lot of good questions on the front end. That's good. Okay, Ryan has another question.
I don't want to beat a dead horse, but before we start going through sections, it'd be important to me to see EPA's draft comments. We're going to start discussing a section, but we all have to realize once this document's final, if they don't mutually agree to it, they can do something completely different than that document. So as we're discussing this, is it possible to get a copy of those? I mean, I'm not saying we have to abide by them. You can fight that out later.
Sure.
But it would be important to know if we're saying we want to take it one direction and their comment is the other direction, I think that would be important to know.
Okay. We can work to get that. So you're saying you would like that now during this discussion?
Well, I just
or before
think
as, we leave today.
As we go through, you start going through sections, and they have a specific comment on a section, we're kind of only discussing part of the issue. We'd have, if we can't get that.
Yeah, we can, as we're beginning, then we can go get that printed, and we can get that done. Yeah. Who do you think would be? Yeah, okay, Mary knows where they are. Okay, Mary's going to do it. So we're going to get those printed off. Okay, that's a good point. Anybody else? Okay, very good. So I think what we'll do is we'll begin. We have some slides. If there's a thinking that folks who maybe are not grounding in aquatic ecology. And stream ecology. So we have some slides that can help us through certain basic aspects of stream ecology. If some people need to get a little primer, we have little primer slides that everyone's going to be able to have a better understanding if that's going to be necessary for some of the issues on the assessment methodology. I look around, but it looks like I can see everybody's knowledge as I look around, so I think we're going to be good. But let's get started. Anything else I miss?
We have some copies of the compilation comments, so that if there's anyone here who needs those, I can pass those out. Also, because we have people on the phone, if you could please state your name before you speak, that way the people on the phone will know who's speaking, and likewise, people on the phone, if you could state your name before you speak, we'll know who's speaking on the phone. So if you could raise your hand if you need a copy of these.
Okay. And Mary should have that, the Stacey Dwyer's comments. Okay, good. I'll pass this along to anybody on this side that wants to chime in. So what can you, if you can do this, if you can grab the compilation of the comments, and we'll begin with specific input, and then you need, what you're going to need, I would recommend, is to have the assessment methodology with you. Does everybody have the assessment methodology? And if not, we can bring it up on the, Christy's helping out, but we can bring the assessment methodology up as well if you don't have it with you. And Christy will do that when she sits back down. What we've done, again, if you look at the input, the specific input, you'll see that we have identified the person who gave the comment. These are, again, these are in part. If you've read the comment and you, I don't know, maybe you're familiar with that commenter's position, then, and you feel like we've missed something, then please say that. And it, again, we definitely want your critical comments, but just make sure that you don't talk over anybody else. So the first comment was on the forward itself. It's on page III. If I have that correct, I think I do. Removing the word subsurface weakens the 2018 assessment of the waters of the state's waters. This Ms. Binning suggested that it remain. I will say that we do monitor groundwater in the state. We have a number of stations set aside in the state that we continually monitor. The regulation number, we do not include the groundwater in the assessment, because if you look in Reg 2, it does not say, it says surface waters. So that is the reason that we do not evaluate the groundwater with Reg 2. Now, if it comes to the surface and it's in a spring, then we evaluate it according to Reg 2. I think that this reflects, perhaps we have used this language from our 305B report, our integrated report specifically, where we do have a chapter on groundwater. So perhaps we have cut and pasted from our 305B report into that, and so that's the reason that is in there. But anybody have any input on that? I heard the phone buzz. Is there anybody on the phone that has any input? Yes, Mr. Easley.
Press that little button until it turns green.
All right. Randy Easley, really more of a question than anything else, but what you just stated as far as subsurface waters, what it emerges as a spring, for instance, you know, in lakes and reservoirs, for instance, we have a significant input from groundwaters that may not necessarily be a spring. So there is a little bit of a concern, particularly as far as pollutants migrate into waters, that there still is potential to have input from subsurface waters that may not necessarily meet that specific definition that you're utilizing. So I'm just a little bit curious if you could explain a little bit more about that influence and impact that we may miss by removal of that term.
I'm thinking, I don't talk out loud, I think in my head. So if I'm just seem like I'm vacant, I'm not. I'm just thinking. This specific sentence, the first sentence in the foreword, is essentially just talking about what we do in the water quality planning branch. I do not think it is that we are not evaluating any type of subsurface flow into the streams. I don't think that it is that we're not evaluating it. If we sample the surface water, it takes consideration any subsurface flow which may come into the stream, like base flow, for example. So it's not that we're not missing it. We are capturing it in determining the water quality there. So I don't think it is that we're, by taking this out, if we were to take it out, I don't think we're missing. This is just essentially an explanatory sentence for what the planning branch does.
Okay, I understand that.
Okay.
Because obviously once that subsurface water hits a surface water, then mm-hmm. we are, in essence, capturing what that
right.
effect may be. But,
mm-hmm.
you know, in our business, we're trying to prevent any kind of impact. So we're
yeah.
trying to discover whether or not there are impacts from that subsurface flow
mm-hmm.
prior to getting into our resource of concern.
Yes, I agree. And so we are monitoring we're monitoring the groundwater. Now I will say that it's not completely and utterly comprehensive, so we're able to get every situation that you're maybe talking about where it may enter near a drinking water intake. We're just not able to monitor all of those. We're able to monitor certain, what we try to do is monitor certain aquifers, and you know, in the past few years we've added in the past 5 years or so we've added a monitoring area for Fayetteville Shale area with that explosion, and so we try to monitor that just like we're not able to monitor all streams. We try to have a good net, cast a large net, if you will. I didn't answer your question, I don't think, but
That's okay. I'm just
okay.
Kind of my point was is
yep.
that just making sure that if we remove that, then
mm-hmm.
we're not expecting you guys to monitor every single situation,
yeah.
but not excluding it from the need for monitoring.
Oh yeah, I believe that we are covered.
Okay.
Based on the network that we have in place, and if anybody wants to know about the groundwater monitoring network, it is represented in the 305B report, in the integrated report. In I don't know what chapter it is off the top of my head, but Colleen has something to say. Go ahead, Colleen. Make it look green.
Colleen Gaston, and this. Is jumping ahead a little bit, but while you mentioned the 305B report,
right.
one of Beaver Water District's comments during the informal comment period mm-hmm. was a request, and we've made this multiple times and under different comment periods, to release the 305B report simultaneously with the 303D report, mm-hmm. and I think that would help in terms of Randy's, you know, comfort level, ours as well, that some of these other issues that aren't directly addressed in the 303D report, such as subsurface groundwater, that we have some information on that. So I know we may be talking about this later, but I just wanted to throw it in here since it had come up.
Right. We did receive that. We have received those comments, and we are taking that into consideration. The report is large, and so in the 303D list is the primary component of the 305B report, mostly for most states, and it is for us too. So it takes a lot of effort to get the list together and then the entire 305B report. But we hear your comment, and we have discussed that as far as our schedule and how to accommodate that. So thanks. Okay, so it sounds like, again, I reiterate that this is just the first sentence in the foreword, and it essentially it captures what our section does. Yes, Teresa.
Hi, Teresa Turk, Buffalo River Watershed Alliance. So I just want to, we've had a lot of discussion about this groundwater component portion. Does this represent, by excluding this term groundwater, does that change anything that ADEQ is doing currently or has been doing in the past?
Absolutely not. Yeah.
Okay, so it's really just, it's just in there to clarify. Okay.
That's a good summarization. Yes, I agree.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other comments on the first sentence? Oh, Jim has one.
Jim, there it goes. Jim Malcolm. Just a general comment. You know, this is the first sentence, and
yes,
we spent 30 minutes on it.
Right. I agree.
I'm not sure that, you know, just a personal comment, I'm not sure that we require that you answer every question that's raised. Maybe some of these are just compiled and collected and answered. I don't personally think that you need to be on the spot for answering or coming up with answers to all these comments in these meetings necessarily, Sarah. If you feel you need to, go for it. But it's possible that, you know, we may need to move on and get subjects out.
Right. Yeah, I agree. My nature is accommodating, is to be accommodating, much like Jim's is. But I concur. So let's move on, if there are no objections, to our second comment. I'm really glad we set aside four sessions. Let's see. Assessment background. the commenter urges us to be to have any and all subsequent reports and recommendations are in accordance with all relevant and applicable parts 40 CFR 122, which has to do with permitting, NPDES permitting process. 130, 40 CFR 130, has to do with assessments. This is particularly for this process. And then 40 CFR 131, which has to do with standards. I assure you, we are following those, and that is one of the very reasons that we have this process and that you're involved in this process, to ensure that we're following it and we're doing it rigorously. So let's go to integrated reporting categories. And if anybody has any comments or believe something contrary to what I say, please chime in. Arkansas River Stewards has a comment. Essentially, it's related to the categorization, and this is going to be, I think, on page 8 and 9 of the assessment methodology, if you want to go there, section 2. You'll see we have category 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 5. If a stream is impaired, it will be in category 5. So when you look at the list, it has category 5. That's all the category 5s. Now, we do have category 4s, which are for streams that generally you can say that there are team DLs developed for those streams, and so that's the reason they're in category 4. But which we're really going to be talking about category 5 stream segments through this process. we may dip into 4, but we're really talking about 5. So the commenter, if I can capture this appropriately, they're concerned about the protection of the streams. If they're put in a specific category, waters which are impaired by point source dischargers, and future permit restrictions are expected to correct the problem. This is category 4B that the commenter is, this category is all about knowing the future. And then there's a Yogi Berra quote in the comment. category low, five, category five low. The waters ADEQ assessed as an impaired, but were assessed as impaired by EPA. That's one of the categories for low. I mean, the subcategories or rationale for a low. There's a recommended hierarchy of category five waters for development of TMDLs. Any national river or ORW stream that is not attaining one or more water quality standards or water assessed by EPA or ADEQ to be impaired. Let me just say this. The commenter is concerned, I think, that we are not adequately categorizing. We need to categorize in a different way. These categories are given in the integrated report guidance document by EPA. This one through five, I have not come across a state that does not use this categorization. The software that EPA has developed uses this categorization for the assessment process. In the past, what we've done for Category 5 is we've called it, some of you may be familiar with this, is called it Category 5A, 5B, 5C, and so on and so forth. We've done that in the past, which we can do. States are, EPA is fine with that, but they definitely want to ensure that Category 5 is there, and they do have, I don't recall if the integrated report actually has high, medium, and low. But their suggestion or recommendation to categorize in a different way, but this is directly from the integrated report from EPA, and it's been this way for decades. Well, not decades, but at least one decade or so, a little bit more actually. Does anybody have any input on that, on the categorization? Yes, Mike.
Sarah, I appreciate that. Mike Armstrong. Appreciate that. I did not realize that these categories came from, I thought this was something DEQ created itself. I think one of the problems with this is not so much the categories, but the definitions of the categories are very general, and it appears to leave DEQ with a lot of latitude and discretion about when it's going to address an impaired water.
Okay.
And I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but I think it would help if there was some description about how waters are assigned to these categories. For example, one in five that catches a lot of attention is the one that says, the medium category, where future permit restrictions are expected to correct the problem. Well, again, you're kind of guessing into the future about whether that's even going to happen. So if you have an impaired water, it could sit out there just kind of indefinitely without any timetable for resolution.
Okay.
And so it just gives a, you know, reading this from an outside reviewer just gives you a sense of, okay, you know, when is DEQ going to address these impaired waters? What makes one a high level versus a low level? Because again, the attributes ascribed to those tiers are very general in their description.
So what you're thinking about is some description of a protocol. If it's in A, then I don't know, a team deal will be done in X amount of time, or it will follow this path. It will follow this path as far as addressing it,
I don't have a solution right now, but I can see the commenter's problem with it,
because
it just leaves you, okay, you know, DEQ seems to have a lot of discretion here, and it may not be. Y'all may have some internal process that y'all assign these things that are not apparent in the descriptions here.
Yeah, well,
I'd say a little more transparency on how things are categorized, high, low, or
absolutely
medium would be.
So that's based off our, I guess in a certain way, we do follow a protocol when it. Yeah, someone's on the phone. What did you have? Hey, Selena, can you hang on just a second? We're going to put a microphone really near the intercom.
Yeah. Go back. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead, Selena.
Okay.
I would like to direct everyone to the 2006 IR guidance. On page 63, it talks a little bit about prioritization, and I think that might help straighten a little bit out. Additionally, it was a little hard to hear Mike, but I think maybe he mentioned category 4B and timelines. In the 4B report, there are going to be timelines and interim steps that are going to move that water towards meeting water quality standards. So that's where you're going to find your timeline there. Timelines for TMDLs are a little bit more fluid based on state resources and when they can actually get the report done.
Oh, she referenced the IR guidance, that integrated report guidance that I mentioned kind of in the beginning of this discussion with the categorization and prioritization. So that's what she was talking about. So page 63 is where that is. And again, that's what we follow. It's what we don't, well, I would say it's what we have to follow when in this process. So it's integrated report or IR guidance is what we commonly talk about. And so what she's saying, excuse me, if you look at, so if we're on page 9, if you look at that 4B, I'm sorry, right, other pollution, if you look at 4B at the very top of the page, other pollution control requirements are expected to result in attainment of water quality standard. And then we have waters which are, and then you go to medium, waters which are impaired by point source dischargers. They're very similar. Typically, the 4B category is utilized for an impairment, but what we need to be doing internally in the Office of Water Quality is looking at our permit for that facility, perhaps is in that segment, and say, hey, we need to be thinking about a limitation to address that particular pollutant pair. Does that make sense? Teresa's looking at me like, no, that doesn't make sense. But That's the intent of that, is to say, is to address a listing with that a limitation, or address it through a permit. So it's very similar. But overall, I feel like what you're saying is your desire is to see more transparency on how this categorization, how we place it in different categories. And I will say that it's really, a lot is based on our knowledge of the stream and what's going on in the stream in that particular segment, based on permittees and what we've seen throughout the years in that segment or that station, and resources, actually. Does that make sense? Darsha. Can someone pass Darsha the microphone? Thank you.
I think a simple Darsha Ruth with Arkansas Department of Health. I think a simple clarification with the cited reference here would really make a difference.
Okay.
And that's true kind of throughout. I know there's a good reference list, but it's not annotated necessarily. So for people who are not public policy wonks, and I doubt any of us are, forgive me if you are, you're smarter than I am then. But I think that would really clarify here what was coming from ADQ versus what was coming through from EPA. And there are several other places like that here.
Okay. So an attempt at clarification on our part then?
I'll go back. My original premise is it seems to place impaired waters in a limbo state without any clear indication about how that's going to be resolved in a time frame for resolution. Mm-hmm. And it gets to the core of the anti-degradation policy that, you know, DEQ can't let that just continue infinite, you know, on into the future without some resolution. So maybe just a clarification that there is the intent, or I don't know how to do it, Sarah, and I don't want to wordsmith it here, but it certainly leaves the impression that there's this limbo state that waters can sit in indefinitely. And I think that's what needs to be corrected.
Okay.
As Sarah, this is Randy Easley. Just kind of a recommendation, if you all would include links on that page to these referred documents, make it easier for us. I mean, I can go find it, but I'm lazy. So if you wouldn't mind putting links to the IR document and a couple of the other documents we've been talking about, that'd be really helpful for us.
You bet.
Thanks.
You bet. And Teresa has a comment. Yes.
Yeah, I think, you know, just a better description. Like, for example, high, truly impaired. Well, it would seem that if it was already in a Category 5, it was already meeting those criteria. So to me, I mean, I'll take a look at the new reference that you all provide from EPA, but there just seems like this is really not very well described, and especially temporally, like Mike was just talking about. And if they're already in a Category 5, a TMDL should be performed. Shouldn't have to have this hierarchy necessarily.
Well, you...
I mean, I can comment. I've been trying to get...
Oh, you are? Okay, I'm sorry. Here.
Hopefully, I guess to defend this language, though, that we all have to know that assessment methodology, I made this speech at the Oklahoma Arkansas meeting last week, just because something is assessed as impaired, it doesn't actually mean it's impaired in actuality, because we're subject to the sampling protocol and the samples we get. So it's very easy that there's, I mean, we know there's streams out there that are impaired that are not listed in the impaired list, and we know there's streams that are impaired on the list but aren't really impaired because, you know, the process is flawed, but not flawed in a way we can't fix, and that is you take one sample a month, generally, so you have 12 a year. If you took one a day, you're going to get different impaired lists than if you take one a month. So I think the language maybe can be changed, but the intent is, okay, so you have to do TMDLs. Let's say you have 50 TMDLs to do. The question comes down is, which TMDL do you do first and which one do you do last, because Sarah and them can only do so many TMDLs at a time. And so the language is trying to get at, okay, if you can handle the issue with a permit limit, then you're better off doing a TMDL on this receiving water that you can't handle with a permit limit and handle the impairment with a permit limit. Or if they believe in their discretion that that a water is looked impaired on the list but is likely to come off in 2 years based on some reason, it's already been solved. So that's kind of the intent of the language. It is impaired if it's in Category 5. I mean, it just is. This language doesn't change its impaired status. It only is a prioritization of TMDLs. And I mean, that, at least that's my, you know, so, and if my understanding is that there's 13 years to get a TMDL done if it's in Category 5. So the timeline is set. So now people may say that's a long time, and it is, but you got to understand how long it takes to do a TMDL in the process. So it wouldn't stay there forever, and Sarah and them doing the list right, every 2 years they look at it again, and if 2 years after putting a permit limit in, you're still impaired, then I would expect that wouldn't stay in medium category anymore. It would move to a new category because the permit limit didn't help. But there's no need for the department to run out and do a long TMDL process for a stream that they honestly don't believe needs to be addressed through a TMDL, because what that means is there's another stream that does need a TMDL that they're not doing it on, because you can only do so many TMDLs at a time. So just remember, this language, it doesn't change the impaired status. It's a prioritization of TMDLs. I mean, right?
Yeah, that's true.
This is Polina. Ryan is correct, and I want to point out that this is for TMDL development over the next 2 years. So it's not all that prioritization is. The high is what the state thinks they're probably going to get to in the next 2 years. They might get to the medium, they might get to the low. But if you look at the regulation at 40 CFR 130.7B4, it says the priority ranking shall specifically include identification.
Mike Armstrong again. That being the case, this discussion has been good, and maybe that's all it really needs to say is just if you can summarize or capture what Selena and Ryan said, I think that would bring a lot of clarity to
okay.
why these are categorized the way they are, why the language is. Mm-hmm. Again, it just leaves the impression they're just out there in this limbo.
Right.
And there's no clear-cut path of how it's going to be resolved out. But if this is a way to categorize and prioritize TMDLs, that's probably what it needs to say rather than...
It does. You're right.
These things here.
So that's a good recommendation. Thanks, Mike. And thanks, everybody, for that... for all that discussion. Anybody have any other? Okay, Teresa.
I'm sorry, I've got one more follow-up suggestion. So Ozark River Stewards recommended a hierarchy. Could those not also be included in your prioritization about which TMDLs are conducted within 2 years? I mean, it would seem like a national river or outstanding resource water would move that up simply because of its tiered effect within the Clean Water Act. Or tier designation,
right? We can take that as a recommendation. I can see that. We prioritize similarly in other parts of our program. I can see that. Okay. Anybody else? Colleen, did you have something? Well, I mean, your hand went up, so it made me think that you're going to say something. Okay. And everybody, you only have 10 comments per session, so that's, no, I'm joking. No, go ahead.
Colleen Gaston, and a comment we've made previously, but not this go-around, was actually on the 303D list, is that we, like the national rivers and so on, we believe that drinking water sources yes. should automatically receive a higher prioritization.
Now I was thinking about that, actually, when in my mind when you were saying that. So thanks. Yes, John.
John Pennington, Beaver Watershed Alliance. I just want to make this statement and clarify, just because something shows up as impaired for 2 years mm-hmm. doesn't really mean that it is impaired. It just means that, like Ryan said, the samples that were taken that were available show something might be out of whack. And so one example would be beryllium, for example. Beryllium showed up for a few years in the Beaver Lake watershed, but it was ephemeral. It was there, and then it was gone. And so really, maybe it was impaired. Maybe it really was impaired. But maybe it wasn't, and nobody knows the difference because there was not enough data. And, you know, the best I heard was the wind was blowing right.
Well, in a way, in a way it was, because this can happen many different ways coming on and off the list. But as it relates to beryllium specifically, what happened was the standard actually changed. It was 76 nanograms per liter, and... Nobody knew where that came from, is what happened. EPA didn't know where it came from, so we utilized more of a drinking water number of 4 micrograms, and so 4 micrograms is more than, actually it's not, but anyway, that's actual criteria. So that's what was put in place, and so anyway. It is, yeah. And also what you say makes me think of one more thing, in that, okay, a stream is impaired, a segment is impaired for DO. It's impaired for dissolved oxygen. The dissolved oxygen criteria, when you think about the use that it's protecting, because there's all these, we have, the state has designated goals or uses for all streams in the state. So the designated use that the DO is protecting is aquatic life use. Well, what we can do is say, okay, it's impaired. If we go out and actually do a full assessment of the biology in that stream, it can far exceed the metrics for the aquatic organisms and the diversity that is necessary to have that use met. So the criteria could be below, according to the criteria in our assessment, It can be impaired for DO, but if you go out and look at that aquatic community, it could be exemplary. So you can have those situations as well. So just because the criteria is exceeding does not mean the use is impaired.
And then to take it a step further, naturally occurring issues can look like an impairment, but
yes,
that's just how it naturally is. And, yes, you know, an example would be, you know, your ecoregions separate out turbidity for the southern part of the state versus in the Ozark Highlands.
Right.
And there's not really a one-size-fits-all.
No.
And we don't always know the difference between what's naturally occurring or not. Or, like, for example, on the West Fork White River, 27 mm-hmm. miles is listed. But according to a healthy data set, it's not all impaired.
Right.
And so those things need to be, I just think, understood by everybody.
Yeah.
That just because it shows up as impaired doesn't necessarily mean that it actually is.
Right. The use may not
be
impaired.
It may be called that.
Yeah, because we must call it, we must put it on Category 5. If it's exceeding the criteria, it must be listed.
And then so Category 5 separates out what we're not really sure about that may not be as high of a priority versus what we're very sure about and is.
Because more data may elucidate that there's really not an issue there. The use is really not impaired. And maybe a site-specific criteria will be necessary. So what I want to do right now, we are ending, we just passed the second section, and data quality considerations would be next. We did have a time set aside for a break. So let's go ahead and, if everyone's accommodating for that, Mary, is that good, you guys? We'll go ahead and have a break. Did we establish 10 minutes for those? Our intent is to have a 10-minute break. So let's do that. If everyone can be back at 10:25, we would appreciate that. Thanks.
All right, so we're going to get started again. And Sarah apologizes. She had a commitment that she had to go take care of. Did we have any other comments regarding Section 2, the integrated reporting categories, or does everyone feel we're ready to go on to the next section?
This is Sean Hodges. Just a quick note. Selena's referenced the 2006 integrated report, and it seems to give a lot of clarification to a lot of these questions. And so if by the next time, if that could be disseminated out via the web or something, that would be really helpful.
Yeah, I made myself a note to send out the link to the IR guidance to the group, and we'll also post that on the web. Okay, so the next topic was data quality considerations. It's section 3.2. That's page 11 of the methodology and 2 of the comments. We'll start with ADQ's comment. We had some discussion the last time on how our data was used compared to how we use data from outside sources. And there are situations where we sample the same reach that an outside or one of our sister agencies samples. And so we'll take that data and look at it as a whole package. And we felt that this section didn't really spell that out as clear as it should. So we're hoping to add some clarity throughout section 3.2 about how we handle data sets that are single source and multiple source. And then there was, the public policy panel made some comments regarding if quarterly or bimonthly sampling was adequate for assessment. And this is noted in the tables themselves, in Table 1 itself. I guess we'll just open the floor to discussion on that topic.
I have a mic.
Okay.
Thanks, Mary. Jim Malcolm, and I don't want to back up too much, but just a kind of a general comment on this whole section about data quality. And I think some other folks here may be interested in what you're talking about also, and more discussion regarding representativeness, coverage, frequency, et cetera, and the sort of implications that come out of these listings regarding permit holders and some concerns about just making sure that's all really clear, and the statistics and the study design is really good behind those. I agree pretty wholeheartedly with that. Regarding data quality, I could be just really wrong with this, but there is a basic premise of using data to make decisions that's related to the quality of that data and the evaluation and assessment of that data before you begin making decisions with it. I have to say I find this really light on the discussion regarding what evaluations are performed to look at data quality, what specific numeric assessment numbers are regarding precision, accuracy, duplicate, split, recovery, the usual kind of laboratory and or QA procedures that, frankly, anybody who does any studying under a QAQC plan that ADQ reviews has to supply pretty much the same basic information, so I think you all need to do the same. But some document out there that I know you do it because you have to evaluate the data before you use it, but I think there needs to be some very clear referenced, data review and evaluation document before a lot of this is done, frankly, because it's really hard to turn these things around if some poor data or unrepresentative data, to kind of piggyback on what John was saying, causes a decision to be made regarding impairment. It can be really important to a lot of people down the line. So, general comment, there's a lot of very subjective wording in this, reasonably established, similar types of data or conclusions. Those things really need to be nailed down, in my opinion, a lot better than they are in this document.
Uh, Yeah, this is Randy Easley, and I just would like to agree with Jim that from the constituents that I deal with, some of the concerns are that there's a lot of data out there that DEQ doesn't use, but there's a good reason there's a lot of data that DEQ doesn't use, but they don't understand what that may be. So it would be great to have some clarity, as Jim mentioned, on the protocols and decisions made that goes into using that data.
Yeah, and in our data request letter that we send out to entities, we do note that there needs to be a QAPP that is equal to or more stringent than ADEQ or USGS. But, yes, I can see how we do need to add some of those details in this document.
Yeah, and Mayor, if I might, the existence of the plan is one part of what I was talking about, but the actual validation process and review to make sure that the labs, you know, got proper recovery, the blanks don't have contaminants. I mean, I'm really a little more basic than even that, but so there's two components of that, and what I was more focusing on was the quote validation process, not just the requirement that the data is collected under an approved or good QA plan. That's important also, but you know, there, I mean, we've been associated, and again, any industry, you know, that does a study, you know, has to, you know, show some validation stuff, and, you know, particularly with any kind of grants involved, that becomes really important. But just a warning that, you know, I know y'all do it. It would be really good to have that reference in a kind of concise validation area where people can look and see and just make sure that, you know, it's a good way to look back and see if there's some erroneous, you know, conclusion from it. It's a good way to look back and see it.
Colleen Gaston, and I'm going to be a little bit of devil's advocate here. I do think there is a role, you know, one, we could always use more data than anybody can afford to pay for. And so we have to recognize that there are practical realities in how much data the state or other entities can collect. I do think there is a role for the department utilizing maybe not so much. And you've got these different tiers in terms of how you treat the data. But I wouldn't want the message to go out that some data that's collected, citizens groups, whatever, that that's not going to be even looked at by DEQ. I understand Jim's concern that it not be used in a way that will have permit implications for somebody. But again, when you're just assessing water bodies, I think that this data should be taken into consideration.
Yes, and we agree as well that that there is going to be useful data, and that doesn't necessarily meet all of the QA/QC requirements. We do take all the data that we receive, and we look at it to see if it meets the QA/QC requirements. And if it doesn't, we still look at it and see if it's giving us a picture of, hey, something is going on. And if we feel something is going on, then as resources allow, we go and do further study in that area. And we are trying to work with our IT department to, not for 2018, but for 2020, to make it like a more streamlined data receiving process. So, yeah, the citizen groups, that data we use more, we call screening, where it just kind of gives us an idea that something is going on, so we need to go look at it.
Yeah, great answer, and that's part of what I was going to say. I would never advocate just throwing data out, you know, without proper, you know, review, but there, typically it becomes tiered regarding its uses, Colleen, and you know, some data may have very poor recovery for matrix spikes, and so it's not very accurate, but it could be a general screening. All I'm asking is that, you know, sort of quantitative review of that data for that categorization and specific use really needs to be pretty clear, I think, with the kind of decisions that this gets used for is all I'm saying. But I'm not an advocate for throwing out, you know, hardly any data, actually. But some of it is better than others, and, you know, some can be used for screening. And typically the validation ends up categorizing it like that, which is really helpful.
So on that same point, I guess, to make sure, because that's talking about, I guess, the QAQC side of it. The other one that we're concerned about sometimes gets used is data collected for a particular purpose of a study isn't always the best data to do, isn't representative of actual stream, you know, overall quality. And you have it in there regarding, you know, sampling only during a key period. But if you go out and sample only during storm flow and use that as all flow data, you know, you might get a false impairment. So just, you know, I mean, I think that section's really important to us is because we go out and do some studies or have some data sometime collected, and we're looking for something very specific, and we would never advocate that data being used for overall impairment purposes because it was collected under scenarios that are not ambient scenarios.
Yeah, and I think that situation's exactly why we want to kind of clarify how we use data sets individually and how we use them as a whole. Because like you said, if y'all collected storm-only data and we collected year-round data, then we could take those as a whole. But, yeah.
Yeah, Mike Armstrong. Just a general comment and then one specific that the Arkansas Public Policy Panel made on Tier 4 sampling for assessments. I think the discussion in here even so far has been that how critical the quality and quantity of your data is. And I go back to a statement Ryan made a little earlier that if you sampled every day the same stream that you sampled monthly, you'd come out with a different impairment list. I think gets to the core of how important sampling frequency, you know, the number of samples that you collect. And understanding and acknowledging that there's the department is not wanting to set a minimum number of samples that have to be collected to make certain decisions or have, you know, some rigid sampling regime that didn't allow some flexibility. Understand that and limited resources. I think it's key for everybody in here to understand, while I'm not a water quality expert and don't want to tell the department how to do, I do have experience sampling natural environments that are very highly dynamic, and capturing infrequent events can be very difficult. And so you have a probability of making both false positives and false negatives attainment decisions. And I think that has to always be kept in perspective whenever you're doing an assessment. So I always question, is the department using its resources, you know, the most strategically to make assessment decisions? And I think that has to be always forefront when you're doing an assessment decision, is the quality and the quantity of data. I know, make reference to a white paper that Arkansas Public Policy Panel submitted back in March where Dr. Burkhalter made a recommendation that for assessment decisions, you should never use, you know, bimonthly sampling. You should at a minimum use monthly sampling. You know, I don't know if that's correct or not because, again, I'm not a water quality expert and don't want to tell the department how to do the job in that respect. But I think it would behoove the department to be able to defend the sampling strategy that you're using, both on the ambient water quality monitoring network and the roving. How are the decisions being made that when is a bi-monthly sample adequate or when is a monthly sampling adequate? When do you use continuous monitoring? Those types of things that just bring some clarity and resolution and I guess comfort to me that understands the variability of monitoring or measuring things in the natural environment versus getting back to Ryan's statement, you know, depending on the number of N of samples you have is going to dictate, you know, what your decision comes out to be. Now, I know I rambled quite a bit through that trying to make my point, trying to say, you know, how much sampling is adequate. You always need more. But I think it
to me, it behooves it to keep that in mind, that we may be making decisions with a fairly limited amount of data on an important decision, and that there is always the chance and the risk of making both false positives and false negative decisions based off of that.
I think we can definitely look into that, you know, when.
Well, you know, again, when I don't have a specific recommendation to make in this area, other than, you know, again, it's looking at the tier four sampling criteria for frequency, where it says bimonthly or monthly sampling during key periods. Okay, is bimonthly adequate? Is monthly adequate? Maybe a sampling design based off probability of flows, where you collect during the upper 25% of flows, the median 50% of flows, and the bottom 25% of flows, to make sure you capture water quality, you know, across the spectrum of flows in that body of water. Because you kind of hint at it there, but you don't exactly say it. If nothing else, maybe a statistician that would look at this data and say, based off the variability that you're seeing and the decision, the number of samples that you have, this is the amount of you know, coefficient of variation that can be acceptable. This is the amount of uncertainty that you're dealing with in looking at this data.
Mary, one, just before we get too much further on the data, will you just state for everybody what the period of record is for this assessment? I think I know what it is, but I think it'd be helpful to have that stated. Okay. Oh, so are you going to give it? Are you going to tell us, or okay? But that's for the last one. That's what I'm saying. I think I know what it is, but I think it'd be helpful to have. Okay, so we can have it officially, April 1st, 2012 to March 31st, 2017 will be the period of record. And then the next question, I'm not sure when you said your IT department was working for 2012, but that was more for the non-qualifying type data. Will you be able to make on the website all the data that you're utilizing available this go round, because that wasn't the case for 2016?
We are definitely looking into ways we can do that, but we don't have a clear path yet, but we are looking, we're looking into that. It may just be that we have links to a series of spreadsheets, so I don't. Some of it is still going to be kind of cumbersome, I think. But yeah.
Sean Hodges from the Park Service. This ties into kind of Mike's and Ryan's comments, and it goes into our next comment from us, was that the more data is better, but they still. This last go-around could not use continuous data because it was collected too frequently. And so in the 2018 assessment methodologies, we're wanting to try to find out how we can incorporate the use of this continuous collection sets of data, because that's going to be a lot of data even to share with or among the group. So.
Sean,
And yes, I will agree. That was definitely one of the main topics last year that we got comments on, was how do you use continuous data? And at that time, we were like, we don't quite know how to handle that in the confines of our current methodology. And so since we knew that was going to be a major topic, we're actually reserved that topic for our second meeting so we could really focus down on that. I don't think we quite wrapped up the is quarterly or bi-monthly adequate, or so I think as we discussed, we can try to dig into that further and provide documentation and better justification for the sampling types, and then so we're gonna reserve our discussion on continuous monitoring for next time. So I think we're on the data representative considerations.
Mary, yes. Could I just make one last comment? I would really highly recommend or second what Mike suggested, that you have a statistician go in and actually look at the minimum number of samples required to actually get a relatively tight coefficient of variation. You know, from my limited experience working in water quality, this is a highly variable system. And so the number of samples, and I realize there's financial constraints, absolutely, but the number of samples is way inadequate. And I think having a statistician really dive into that and review that would be very helpful in guidance for the state and other sampling programs that you might undertake.
And I think we can definitely look at how other states, how they review those stats as well.
Jim Malcolm, one more time, sorry, not to beat the dead horse, but this, before we get clear off this, this table one is a great example of what sort of the point I was trying to make is that you've got your data quality column for each of these tiers. And, you know, there's not a quantitative term in it. So how do you know when you switch from row to row? And that really could cause some, you know, nervousness in people that could be affected by these decisions. So just, I'm pretty sure that information's out there, Mary. And but, you know, this wouldn't even pass muster to you guys reviewing data validation criteria in a QAP. It really wouldn't. So you really need to kind of, I think, step up and make sure these things are kind of documented when you're, you know, quantitatively when you're switching from tier to tier.
Let's see, just working down page 3. Looks like these next several from sections 3.3, 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, and 0.7 are all ADEQ comments where we're seeking to continue to clarify how different data sets are used. We talk about clarifying spatial and temporal distributions, looking into the instrument error section. We're going to look into that section as well. I guess, are there any comments on on any of those? Stan.
This is Stanley Sewell. I guess, aren't these comments ones that were just distributed yesterday afternoon, the ADQ comments, or were they in the previous set a week earlier?
The week earlier, these were in a separate document. So they were, there was two attachments. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there was two attachments, and then this is the, yeah. So they were out there, but they were in a
separate.
The second okay. attachment, yeah.
On that, Marion, I know you guys put a lot. You're gonna reevaluate those sections. Are we gonna get to see those? I guess and comment on this issue of spatial and temporal distribution is very important to us at Natural Resources because we just want to make sure. You know, you go out and you're using a 25% exceedance. You take 10 samples in January and then one a month for the rest of the year. You're obviously the January samples are gonna gonna rule, and so making sure that you have a adequately spread out. Sampling populations important to us. So as you make changes, I guess, I'd hope we'd get to see those and comment on those as you propose changes.
Yes, we will. I think it was mentioned when Sarah gave the presentation that at the end of the stakeholder group, all the recommendations we put into one document, and then we'll have a public notice.
I mean, I guess, are we going to get to discuss them as a group? Not the public notice, but I mean, I guess that, I mean, I'm not trying to be critical, but everyone here, they provided, there's comments we're discussing specific changes, but y'all's notes say you're going to propose something in that section. Are we going to discuss the changes? The only reason, I mean, I said that's, if you were to change it to weaken the temporal distribution section, you know, I'd want to comment on that more than the formal comment period, I guess.
Yeah, I think... we did want to receive the input here. If y'all, like, if you don't think a section needs to be revised, then we'll leave it alone. But if y'all agree that it needs to be revised, then we'll definitely work toward it. I completely see your concerns. I'm not exactly sure what the timeline is for that. So we can discuss that and let y'all know if we think we'll be able to have that to you before.
And, you know, it's not that it needs to be changed. It's how. I mean, I guess I'm not really sure how you're going to change it, meaning are you going to weaken the temporal distribution section or strengthen it, as in make it, you know, more that it has to be, you know, spatially and temporally distributed or less?
Well, I think our intent would never be to weaken it, but I think our intent would be just to clarify the language to specify that it should be evenly distributed.
Mary, if I might, Jim Malcolm again. Ryan, I mean, one, yeah, I'm just trying to think of how that, you raise a good question, you know, within the context of the timing of this meeting may not be able to be answered. But, however, if your organization has, you know, issues with the way it's written or not, you know, maybe that's the best way to address this. So, you know, if there's a change considered and that, you know, may or may not change, you know, and you guys like the wording, maybe you should say, hey, we really like the wording, or.
Sure, and I guess that's true. I guess the thing I'm wondering, though, is by the DEQ comment just says they're going to reevaluate it. And I was just wondering if we're going to see what that reevaluation will conclude in prior to the public notice. I mean, you know, especially from a natural resources standpoint, we're not really big on public putting public comments on a sister agency's public notices, so we would rather work through those. I mean, I'm to me, if anything, this section is good or needs to be clarified so that it's very clear that you don't make an assessment decision on a season biased or a flow biased or a study biased sampling population. I mean, to me, that's I'm very supportive of that. The more they can clarify that, so because now it's kind of the language now is kind of like the intent is not or they should not. So the more it's clarified that they don't, is better to me. But if this were to change be less strengthening, mean more data taken out of season be considered greater, then obviously we'd comment on that. So you see what I'm saying? I mean, I support the language as it is now, and is any way it can be spelled out greater, I'm in favor of.
Yeah, and I as we mentioned earlier, I think this is one of the sections where how we use individual data sets and aggregate data sets, that I think that will come into play here as well. Because like you said, you know, somebody may collect a whole bunch in, you know, one season, but somebody, you know, two or three other agencies or groups may be collecting year-round. So we're just going to intend to kind of clarify that. So I'll have to talk with some others here. I don't want to make a commitment that we're going to have that out in a certain time period if we can, but I'll let y'all know.
Colleen Gaston, and I guess this is again sort of a devil's advocate comment. I think it is good, and I agree with Ryan. It'd be nice for this group to be able to see that information if possible. I think there is a danger that should be recognized that if ADQ is very specific on exactly what data and the timing and all sorts of, you know, variables, if they try to control all that in terms of what data will be used, there's a danger of never having the data that qualifies. And so, you know, I think you need to balance between having good data, very good data, but also being realistic in terms of the finances that are available to the different agencies to do the sampling. And so, I think that all needs to be taken into consideration, and we don't want to go too far down the road of saying this is exactly how you have to do the sampling and when and so on.
Yeah, it is definitely not our intent to make the methodology where it hinders work that other agencies or other groups do.
Yeah, Mary, just a follow-up, just a comment, I understand what Colleen's getting at, because it's always a balance between resources and how much data you can collect. You know, the goal here is that you have a data set that's representative of the actual conditions out in the stream. What I'm looking for are two things. Is the design that's currently written adequate to assure an independent outside observer that that's being done? And I agree with Jim Malcolm. I don't think it is. It's very general in description. There's no quantification of how you move from one tier to the next. And then the second thing is just how is there needs to be some acknowledgement or consideration of the variability in the data set, that there's the actual variation that's occurring out there, and then there's the amount of variation that you see in your sample set, and your sampling should mimic the natural variability of the system that you're measuring. And if it's not, then something's wrong, because then you have a high chance of sampling during a period of that's going to give you either that false positive or that false negative. And so I think the comment that a statistical review of the sampling regime and the sampling design should bring some clarity to, are you capturing those infrequent but significant events adequately?
I think right now this might be a good time to take our final break, because when we conclude at noon, we're going to have to leave. We're going to have to get the room cleared out fairly quickly to set up for a 1 o'clock meeting in here. So if we could go ahead and take a quick 10-minute break, make sure you're back in your seats on time, and then that way we can hopefully power through this last hour and get it all wrapped up today. Thank you.
Hello. Can everybody please start finding their seat again?
Welcome back, party people. It's time to get started. If you could please take your seats, we're going to get started right now. Thank you.
I wasn't forceful enough.
Okay. And I'm just looking, just kind of generally speaking again on page three. From what I understood of everyone's discussion is they do feel like clarification is needed in some of these areas, and if possible, the group would like to see that before the official public notice, and we're going to have an internal discussion regarding that, and I will let y'all know. Let's see, on page four, a public policy panel had a comment about, you know, small data sets.
Mary, this is Mike Armstrong. Again, that goes back to our previous discussion. So, I mean, we can move on from that, but just making note that, again, you know, the quality and the robustness of your data is critically important in these decisions, and that's what Mr. Burkholder was getting at. Is that an adequate number of samples for an assessment?
All right. The next section is section 310. For those who aren't familiar, WQAR is the program that ADEQ uses to assess data. This section will just need some updates, you know, based on standards revisions. And so we just wanted to let y'all know we will be changing, like any changes in this document, we're going to have to make in our assessment program.
Hi, Teresa Turk here, Buffalo River Watershed Alliance. So I had a question about your, that's a computer program, correct? So I could not find any, and maybe I missed it, any reference to that program, what parameters are used, how long it's been in use, is it only specific to ADEQ's process, or is it used by other state entities? Is there a location or is there a citation that you could include in there that would allow for greater digging into the program, greater discussion about that?
It's not surprising that you couldn't find anything because at this time we don't really have anything out there on our website that discusses the WQAR program. We used it for the 2014 and the 2016 cycles. It is used by ADEQ only. Right now, it only accepts ADEQ data. All the outside data we still have to assess the way we did before we had the program. We are currently working on hopefully trying to get it to accept the outside data as well. Yes, currently the program does not assess the outside data.
But the data is being used.
Yes, yeah, we still receive that data, and we use the process that we used before. We look at it by hand.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I do think it would be great if you could provide a document about that program. It would be, I think, very insightful and helpful for us outside reviewers. Thanks.
Okay. Our next discussion topic is the anti-degradation, section 4.1. So does anybody have any further comments? We had, I was like River Stewards, National Park Service made comments.
Teresa Turk again. Clearly, there's a deficiency in your anti-degradation policy, and I'm just wondering if this is a high priority for ADEQ to add some of these definitions and processes and methodologies in this coming cycle, because clearly there's quite a bit that's missing that needs to be added to your process.
I know that we do have the anti-degradation policy in Reg 2, and I know that I think the EPA has provided, I guess, some additional guidance regarding anti-degradation. So I know that we're currently reviewing that additional guidance.
But are any other efforts besides the EPA guidance going to be taken into consideration? And is it only within Regulation 2 that these recommendations would be added, or can they be addressed and added within this process right here?
Well, we would have to make sure anything that was added in here was not in contrast to the reg. So I think details could be fleshed out in this document as long as they didn't seem contrary to the reg.
Okay. I mean, the reg really, in Regulation 2, there really doesn't say much. So I can't imagine them being in conflict. I think what Ozark River Stewards is asking for more procedures to be put in place that actually comply with Clean Water Act's area on anti-degradation.
And this is Randy Easley, just kind of following up on that. So you mentioned EPA guidance or additional input on anti-degradation. Was that in response to Reg 2 changes, or what was the context of their guidance?
No, that was not specific to Arkansas. I believe that was a nationwide policy.
Okay, thanks.
I was just going to quickly ask if you could make the EPA guidance available on the website so that we could get or send it out, you know, as an attachment to the work group. That'd be great.
The addition of numeric criteria, that would be handled under the regulation and not the methodology. So that would be a triennial review issue.
Sorry, green light was tough. Melissa Lombardi, Fish and Wildlife Service. I was just looking at the designated use, the aquatic life. This is probably a Reg 2 thing, I would expect to be the answer, but I just wanted to check and see if there's weight given to either threatened and endangered species or species of greatest conservation need within that biological integrity, or if it's more just a community difference.
The designated uses are more clearly spelled out in the reg, but there are separate designated uses for the
ERWs, ESW waters that have certain endangered species. Those aren't specifically spelled out in this table, but I guess we could work toward that if that was something that the group would like.
Stanley Sewell. Mary, I wanted to back up to the anti-degradation just for a second. You'd indicated a minute ago in a response that you had some information from EPA on anti-degradation. Is that in any of the information that y'all have provided us?
No, it is not.
Okay. But so I guess gets back to my basic question. The current anti-degradation policy that ADQ has, does it meet EPA's acceptance at this time?
Yes, it does.
Okay, thank you.
Do we have any more discussion about anti-degradation policy? Okay, I guess this gets us into the next, Jim, are you speaking? Sorry.
Jim Malcolm, Mary, just a thought off kind of the top of my head for ADEQ on this. I guess it's your document, obviously, but I think by not just referencing some of these sort of priority documents, and you run the risk of sort of contradicting yourself by getting into some of these subjects, in my opinion, when they're better spelled out in other places. And you might consider referencing those documents rather than trying to sort of have a shortened discussion that may not be either very clear or even factual in this document. Just a comment, you know, you may get by better off with just referencing those things that really talk about these things.
Okay, so we're going to start on the next chapter 5, the general standards. We received a comment about an issue, or I guess a topic that is not currently in the methodology. The comment was to develop an assessment for nuisance species, and Reg 2.402 regarding nuisance species was mentioned. Reg 2.402 says all water shall be free from substances attributed to man-caused point or non-point source discharges in concentrations that should produce undesirable aquatic biota or result in the dominance of nuisance species. Are there any thoughts here on, I guess, ways that we might incorporate a nuisance species assessment? Or has anybody seen something of that in that regard?
Melissa Lombardi, Fish and Wildlife Service. I have not seen nuisance species, but I'm sure other states have developed something similar. So if that's something we can look at individually and then come back with ideas at the next meeting, that might be a way forward. but at least for the service, I think addressing nuisance species as part of water quality and overall aquatic health is important.
John Pennington, Beaver Watershed Alliance. If nuisance species is something that's going to be included, there needs to be a distinction between what would be related to non-point source pollution or point source pollution versus just other anthropogenic effects. If somebody brings something and puts it somewhere and it doesn't have anything to do with pollution, or if overuse of a certain resource shifts species composition.
Okay, so it sounds like we're gonna dig into that some, and we'll come back to that discussion next time.
Mary, just a comment before we leave that real quick. The state of Arkansas does have an aquatic nuisance species plan that has been signed off by the governor and accepted by the national organization from Fish and Wildlife Service that vets those. So if there is a need to meld Reg 2 in those, I just want to throw out there that referencing the current plan that has been accepted for Arkansas may be suitable for what the commenter is getting at. Because certainly, I mean, coming from Game and Fish, we realize the problems of aquatic nuisance species and how they can impact, you know, designated uses, both agricultural, industrial, primary contact, recreation, fisheries, and those sorts. So there are impacts out there. I've always been kind of leery of saying this is a source of pollution. There are folks say, well, it is. It's a biological polluter. But so it may be just appropriate to make reference that there is an aquatic species nuisance plan already in place and already being implemented by a sister agency here in Arkansas that has been accepted by the governor and by the National Aquatic Species Council.
Darsha Ruth with the Health Department, and I think one of the things that's really on our radar with the drinking water systems is the prevalence of cyanobacterial blooms and the impacts on drinking water systems and treatment trains and health advisories that affect both body contact and ingestion of the contaminants. And I know some of this is going to need to be more appropriately addressed in the triennial review that's just around the corner, really. But that's one thing that is on our radar now, and I think it's on a lot of people's radar because of the horsehair algae bloom and the buffalo this last summer. I think, you know, that's not necessarily how everybody thinks of nuisance species, but that's definitely from the drinking water side one of the things we're really concerned about. And one of the issues there is that EPA has issued some pretty low numbers in terms of drinking water systems having to meet these numbers, and also putting with their advisory that was last summer. Yeah, and they're probably going to have recreational numbers that come out before the next summer season, and a lot of this is driven by Ohio and the things that have happened there. And it honestly, that advisory came out in a hurry, and there weren't a lot of the stakeholder type process and the studies that we're used to seeing, and I totally understand that. And we do have the work group that's really trying to address these things, and I think that is good. But the drinking water utilities have their work already to provide safe water that won't harm public health. It'll be safe for their people to drink. And putting the onus on them to prevent cyanobacterial blooms and to do all the monitoring for that in watersheds. So that's one of the things I think that's driving some of this need for, by reference, getting the nuisance plan in there. So that was rambly, but that's, I know, on a lot of our constituents' minds and as a concern.
Mary, I've got a very simple, stupid question. So instead, I know we have this in Reg 2, but doesn't the other assessments of macroinvertebrates and fish, doesn't it get to that? I guess what I'm wondering is, you already assess for a change in fish community, you change from a change in quantity, I mean, you already assess that in your other assessments, correct? I mean, if you would have a shift to a dominant nuisance species, that would show up in your other assessments, or would it not?
Well, I think in some situations it definitely would, but as you're aware, we don't have the resources to do biological sampling everywhere. And, you know, if there's the massive algae blooms are quite visible, and so the public can be really aware of those. And we may not have the resources to go out and do the other biological sampling there to see if that bloom is negatively affecting aquatic life or not.
I just want to add to that. This is Randy Easley again. Of course, reading directly from here, it talks about all water shall be free from substances attributed to man-caused point or non-point source discharges and concentrations that can produce aquatic biota or dominance and nuisance species. So really what we're talking about here at the core, yes, there are ways and methodologies at identifying nuisance species in the state. But the core of this, and particularly go back to what Darcia said about harmful algal blooms, is really a nutrient issue. So to me, that's what this is driving at, is a better, maybe a better defined way of looking at how man-made point or non-point sources can drive the dominance of a nuisance species. So, and it's almost kind of covered in a way when you look at nutrient standards and TMDLs and all that, but maybe just, again, a little point of clarity of how that ties into the rest of the regulation would be probably pretty useful for most folks.
Okay, somebody else? Are y'all gonna? Okay, so our next topic was another quote from Reg 2. It's 2.408, which is solids, floating material, and deposits. And the commenter was specifically concerned about bottom deposits and scum. And so this is not currently... we don't have a current assessment for the presence of bottom deposits or scum, and the commenter, I guess, was getting at, you know, with a potential need for one. Do we have any thoughts on that topic?
Sure. So from a threatened and endangered species standpoint, the primary drivers of habitat degradation for our species that we're charged with protecting under the Endangered Species Act is excessive sedimentation. So it's erosion, sedimentation. It has an effect on many of our aquatic and aquatic-dependent species. Over half the species listed in Arkansas are aquatic or aquatic-dependent. So it's bottom deposit. We couldn't really find where in Reg 2 to wedge this in, so it would need a new section. But bottom deposits and sedimentation in those little interstitial spaces is a concern for us. It does affect aquatic life, so if we can wedge it in under there somewhere in assessment methodology, Arizona has a great protocol if we need to adapt from theirs. It was our recommendation to look at that.
Mary, Mike Armstrong. I'd just like to support what Melissa Lombardi was just saying. you know, sedimentation is one of the leading problems of degrading waters across the U.S. And bringing clarity, if we can, I think it's worth looking at this Arizona example and seeing if it could be adapted and adopted for Arkansas, or at least a review, or are we appropriately, you know, assessing impacts from sedimentation with the current language narrative standard that we have.
Okay, I think we can definitely look into that Arizona procedure and see if that will fit with our current regs. I think we have just a little over 20 minutes left. So I think at this point we should kind of do our instead of moving on to new topics, we should do a recap and revisit. Has anybody had any epiphanies on the topics we've already covered, something else you'd like to make sure we capture?
I was talking with Caleb earlier. I think some information that that would be really helpful to all of us, certainly would to me, is on page 18, where you're discussing the six major basins, the Red, the Washita, the Arkansas, the White, St. Francis, and Mississippi rivers. Then those are subdivided into 38 water quality planning segments, and then further 1,600 smaller watersheds based on discrete hydrological boundaries. It would be helpful, it's under the spatial concept where there's 16,135 miles of rivers. It would be helpful to know how many streams you're actually monitoring, which ones, ID where they are, whether or not they're monitored monthly or bi-monthly, or what the frequency is. Are they equally distributed in each of those five major basins, or watershed? Is it a watershed approach? How are they chosen, the distribution? If the planning section could maybe put together that information and share it with us either through an email or next time, I think it would help us understand better what we're looking at.
Okay. Yeah, we can do that. And we can definitely. And of course, I think in maps a lot. So I was like picturing maps I could create while you were talking. So yeah, I think we can definitely provide some clarity on the sampling stations and how often they're sampled. Of course, that wouldn't include the outside data sources, though.
And more information, I think, would be helpful on the roving. Water quality monitoring network is bi-monthly adequate, and it mentions a rotating two-year schedule. If you could expand on that.
So I have just a probably this is a dumb question. On under 4.2, that table 6, the designated uses and the associated parameters, could somebody please explain to me how we ended up with these parameters as the key parameters to identify attainment or non-attainment of these uses, please?
My brain completely lapsed on what page you said. I can't give you concrete as to why which parameters were chosen to represent which designated use, but we can definitely look into that and provide clarity there.
The thing that I'm surprised Darcia didn't ask, and the thing that leaps out is, why aren't you know, for domestic water supply, why aren't you using primary standards instead of secondary standards that really are they're secondary, they're not a they're not the same level of concern.
Yeah, they have to deal with treatment, feasibility, and not with human health. And we've had this conversation a lot in the triennial review that there are a lot of regulated substances, and nitrate is one that's come up in some of the discussion. Ammonia is part of that too. And again, and of course,
thank you, John. Darsha Ruth again. Ben Gilley and I are furiously taking notes, you know, go back and discuss in the drinking water program. If we have other substantive comments to share with the stakeholder group about that. And it's the same EPA, but it's very differently administered, the Safe Drinking Water Act and the Clean Water Act. But things that are not covered under Reg 2 water quality, the onus gets put on the drinking water utilities often to go ahead and have that cost. And then, of course, that gets externalized onto their customers in terms of having to improve plants and things like that, higher costs. So we are aware of that, and we'll be looking at that, and would also welcome your input directly to us as we kind of craft a response there.
Mary Mott. Jim, since you raised this table on page 24, I assume, but maybe I should ask the department, you know, they list some parameters that are associated with particular designated uses. I guess I assumed that was not an exclusive list, that you could consider other parameters that might impact, for example, as Darsha said, nitrate. But that's my question. Is this supposed to be an exhaustive list, or is this just a representative list?
It was a general idea. It's not exhaustive.
So I guess the question is, does it need to be made exhaustive? Does it need to be left? Does it need to say that this is a general? You know, there probably some clarification is needed. But I would mention on the minerals issue, it's, you know, I read this as things that are not removed by conventional drinking water treatment, that's primarily is the minerals, which is why it's also a problem for industry. You know, it's difficult to treat for those things. But there are other compounds of concerns, and we've already talked about the cyanobacteria, cyanotoxins, and, you know, the things that produce disinfection byproducts, which we will get to. But I did not consider this an exhaustive table, but again, maybe it needs some clarification.
You're, as usual, Colleen, you're asking the question better than me.
Thanks. I think it was Alice, maybe had asked earlier about water quality monitoring stations and information. ADEQ on their public-facing website has the, AquaView is amazing. It is a gold mine for, I mean, water quality data, fish data. It's definitely a good starting point. I just wanted to make sure, I imagine everybody in this room has used it, but if not, it is a great resource.
Does anybody else have anything they'd like to revisit from our previous discussions? Okay, so have about 15 minutes left. But so for our next meeting, we will definitely revisit some of the topics that we tabled. I think the primary discussion we want to try to work through is the assessment of continuous monitoring data. So I guess, you know, read over those comments and try to really think about how you think that should be implemented before the meeting on the 15th. That would be good.
When
Yeah, I think it's December the 15th, and that one will be in the afternoon. And based on our discussions, there's a few more documents that I'm going to make available to the group and to the website. The IR guidance and the more recent EPA anti-deg document. Does anybody have anything else they would like to add or any topics they think we should discuss before our next meeting?
Thank you. Teresa Turk here. I understood from previous conversations that with the continuous monitoring data that you all had been working with USGS to come up with some methodology. Could you share that with us prior to the meeting on the 15th, if it's available or ready?
I can definitely look into that. We did work with USGS, and they're actually going to be here to present that to the group. The whole group can understand exactly the process that was taken and, you know, the science behind what the investigation provided. So, but I'll look into seeing if I can provide that.
The USGS is here. We do have some of that data, and we're going to be presenting on that next time. If you have specific questions, I can answer some of them after.
All right, I guess we'll adjourn about 10 minutes early. Thank everybody for coming today, and I thank you all for your input.
Sorry, Mary, just to clarify right here. You're still going to, in our next meeting, we're going to start again at 5.0, correct?
Yes, that's correct. I think we'll start with continuous monitoring, and then when we're done with continuous monitoring, then we'll start back at 5.0.
Thank you.
Oh, and just one more thing real quick. One more thing real quick. We really want y'all to keep discussing and work out further input, but we really have to reset this room for the 1 o'clock meeting. If y'all could discuss in the hall, that would be fabulous. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We really do need to get this room reset for the next meeting. So if you could take your discussions outside, that would be fantastic. Thank you.